2 years ago, Billie Eilish released her debut album, When We All Fall Asleep,
Where Do We Go?
I've never listened to this album.
I'm
doing the reaction. I do know a lot of the songs, but I've never listened to it in its entirety.
Right.
I've just always been aware of its impact. I'm aware of how big of an album it is. And yes. So I read here that on a Zane Lowe interview, Eilish explained that the album was largely inspired by lucid dreaming and night terrors, revealing that it is basically what happens when you fall asleep.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing that this is going to be a pretty broad album, if that makes sense, in topics.
I remember I was working at Taco Bell at the time.
Taco Bell?
Yes, Taco Bell.
McDonald's.
I worked at McDonald's.
And my friend was like, hey, like, have you heard this song? And I was like, no, I haven't. Check this by Billie Eilish. It was Bury a Friend. I fell in love with it.
Yeah, Bury a Friend and Bad Guy were really, like, I'm sure with everyone else, was my real introduction into who Billie Eilish was. But I have to say, the thing about Billie, especially with this album and this era, she came at a time where we needed something different.
Yes.
And she was definitely that something different.
Yes.
She was that something fresh that I think the industry really needed. And she took it by storm. So I am excited to get into this album. I'm excited to dissect it. This is it, y'all. Like, this is it.
My Invisalign has taken out my Invisalign, and this is the album.
Pretty simple. Oh, that was a transition.
Perfect transition.
We're starting it off real dark so far.
I love Bad Guy. Dude.
That kick is enough to get your attention. Okay, I just want to say, I like the intro because, like I was saying about that broad idea, it's kind of just like, this album, I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah,
like, this is it. You know what I mean? Like,
the album, yeah.
What did I mean? Like, she, like, bows to him?
No. I mean, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So cynical. So you're a tough guy. Like, you're really a rough guy. Just can't get in. I'm a bad guy.
Duh.
This beat alone is just so, like...
Arguably, though, it's one of the most recognizable in music. I would say so.
Yeah, the instrumental.
Like,
yeah.
I think a long time from now, you're still gonna, like, hear that and be like,
that was Bad Guy. I feel like this has such a sexual...
Yeah. Won't sing this song. Obviously, I ain't singing that.
I'm not doing that.
I ain't singing that one, though.
This part.
I like when you get mad. You said she's scared of me. I mean, I don't see what she sees, but maybe it's cause I'm wearing your cologne. I'm a bad guy.
From the songs that I know, Bad Guy is the only, like, bad guy on the album. You know what I mean? Perfect introduction to just Billie's aesthetic.
Yeah, aura. I agree with you.
Everything. Like, I think Bad Guy was perfect.
It's dark, but it's playful. Like, it's the perfect introduction to the album, like you were saying. I also like the flip. Like, the flip of her being the bad guy. And it's almost like she's teasing him, taunting him, or, you know, egging him on. Like, oh, you like that? You like that? You like that? Well, guess what? I'm that. Can you really handle it? You know what
exactly,
I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
And I do know that she also was describing, like, some of the songs as fiction.
Yeah.
And some is the truth.
Yeah, a little playful.
And you'll never know which is which. It's very muddy production and the distortion and everything.
Yeah.
I like how she uses such soft vocals on a sinister beat. I really think that that's going to be consistent on the album,
Phineas,
which I'm hoping
an incredible
for.
Producer.
Oh, yeah.
What is it about them? I must be missing something. Better off without them.
It sounds like she's in a public setting.
That's
Oh, that is dirty. Wait, okay. Give me a minute. Okay.
Wow, that bass line is tough.
Don't give me this any now or ever. pepper.
Huh.
Waking up at sundown.
Piano.
Morning as they calm down. Their pretty heads up.
Wow, that ad-lib was beautiful.
Make the same mistakes. Blame circumstance. I'm.
Ooh, that was pretty.
Take so many different
what
turns.
What is it about them? Too intoxicated to be scared.
That felt like a nightmare. It was very lullaby-like, but also unpredictable. It sounded like you were being haunted, with that soft vocal on top of such a dark and heavy bass.
Yes.
And the sudden hits as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Especially when you get to, I believe it's the chorus, how that bass comes in so heavy. I actually really like the meaning of this song. I like I said, I have heard it. It's been a while since I've heard Zanny. It's been a very long time. I think it's her witnessing people in her life and her circle do them and just wanting them to be careful.
Be smart, be safe, you know?
Because not all the time does one want to hear, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it.
Yeah.
And so for this song, I think it's beautifully written and just coming from a sincere place.
I agree with you. I also think that the song definitely adds to this difference in characteristic on the album, because the first song being Bad Guy,
you would associate
you know, the things that she's describing in this song with being the bad guy. Most people would, but then for the next song to kind of take on this more innocent role by saying, you know, I don't need a Zanny to feel better.
Don't give me a Zanny now or ever.
Or ever, you know what I mean? It's kind of just like she kind of separates herself from that bad guy narrative.
Yeah, I was literally thinking at the song. I said, it's so ironic that that's going to come after Bad Guy.
Yeah. It's a fear of losing people.
It's
a fear of loss. Yeah.
So that's why when she said, I can't afford to love someone who isn't dying by mistake.
Yeah.
That's very powerful.
Yeah. Knowing that someone is on their road to destruction and you can't do anything
about it
is actually sometimes the hardest place to be put in.
Yeah.
There was also this breath of air that she took. She took this gasp also at one point in the song. I think it was in the middle of the outro somewhere.
The outro, yeah.
Which really described like that pain. Like you could hear like that. There's nothing
almost
I can
helplessness.
Do.
Yeah.
Helplessness is the perfect word.
Yeah.
So that one was very interesting. I didn't expect the meaning to be like that. It kind of speaks from the perspective of the person that doesn't do the drugs.
Yeah.
You know, which is actually pretty rare.
Need to know this song.
Okay, I've seen this title, but I don't know if I know the song.
Oh, you'll know when you hear it.
Okay.
Bite my tongue, bite my time. Wait till the world is mine. Cold in my kingdom side.
The word kingdom and the sound of a sword coming out. It's just little details like that.
Ah, yes.
Yeah.
And then the O into I, ocean eyes, yeah.
You should see me in the crowd.
I know this one. You know the video where she has all those tarantulas on her face?
I'm sorry, y'all have to listen, right? You should see me in a crown. The reference to the kingdom, the pull of the sword. Now she's talking about count the cards, watch them fall. You think the king, queen, joker.
Yes.
The imagery.
Yes.
This is.
Tell me which one is worse, living or dying
first.
You say, come over, baby. I'm okay. I'm not your baby. Crown.
What is this?
Sitting in a crowd.
love that song. I think that was the first single, lead single, first single. I think I'm correct.
This song is definitely empowering in a lot of ways.
I was gonna say, I think this song is a little bit, almost like a, not a cocky song, but I think just proving them wrong. I think
when yeah, with the whole kingdom.
Yeah, make them bow one yeah. by one, and your silence is my favorite sound.
Yeah.
So me doing what you don't think I'm capable of doing.
Right, right.
And again, you should see me in the crown. What you were reading, I didn't know, is based off of a Sherlock quote.
Yeah. I'm not sure that the songs are really connecting in any way so far. Something may hit later.
Yeah.
But right now, it's really just playing with this idea of conflicting views of herself yeah. or these different yeah. personas, because each song is very different so far.
And touches on something different personally.
Yeah, even if it's not personally, it just speaks to how people have so many different faces. You're never just one yeah. person, you know what I mean? It's also situational.
You know, they're like stages of sleep. I don't, I
hey, that, see, that's a good point,
I
wanna though.
I want to see where this goes.
So far is lonely. Standing there, killing time. Can't commit to anything but a crime.
What kind of Lauryn Hill inspired song is this?
Billie's music is like, it never stays the same for too long.
What?
There's always something yet? About it that, like, I don't know, keep listening. The song looks really good.
Oh my gosh.
Peter's on vacation and animals.
Man, I don't know.
even pretend to know what that means, because no one should know what that means. But it's crocheting, it's not like I never got. Yeah, what that mean? I love how random that is, though.
Imagine recording this during Christmas
time. But the thing is, I will say, I love how random it is. However, it's kind of ironic that you're talking about snowflakes on a song about hell. Where a snowflake wouldn't even survive, you know?
Yeah. It's an interesting perspective, because
I got a few.
You know, you hear people say, I'm going to do good all my life.
Yes,
all my life. And when, I mean, hey, that saying is true, desperate times call for desperate measures. Mm-hmm. And anybody has the potential
yeah.
to, I don't want to say be bad.
There is no, I feel like
there's no perfect person.
No, and but even beyond the idea of perfect, I think that it's kind of neutral in the sense that good isn't better than evil and evil isn't better than good. It's
right.
kind of just like you do what you have to do depending on the situation.
Right.
And the ones that are act self-righteous, and I find it funny that this has religious references.
Yeah.
Because some people can use their religious views as a means to feel better than other people.
A little superior,
it's not a song I feel like coming at religious people. It's just kind of saying, and even beyond religious people, it really is just about the fact that there's some people that like to act holier than thou.
I think it's stepping off that high horse.
And that idea of going to hell is going to that bad, dark place.
Yes,
not even literal hell. Yeah, it's going to that place they swore they would never go to. I'm seeing here that there's even references to global warming, and as I was listening, I was going to say, like, Hillsborough in California, animals, evidence. She said something about greenery as well.
And also,
man is such a fool, why are we saving him? Poisoning themselves now, begging for our help. Wow. It's like, we are poisoning the earth, essentially, right?
Yeah.
And it's going to come a point where, like, when things get really bad, we're going to be like, some people might be like, God help us, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or we're going to be looking around for help, and it's like, this whole time,
we could have been preventing this.
We could have been preventing it. Yeah. It speaks to, like, how humans do that. Like, throw back to Zanny. You're doing something that you know is potentially bad for you, and then you kind of act surprised when
it goes south.
You know?
Exactly.
So, this was a very interesting song.
I like this song.
It might be one of my favorites.
Baby, I don't feel so good. Six words you never understood. Five words you never say. If three's a crowd and two is us, one slipped away. I just wanna make you feel okay. Didn't want to stay. I just kinda wish you were gay. Is there a 12 step just for you? Our conversation all in blue.
Damn.
I haven't hit yet. I ate alone at 7, you were 6 minutes away.
Wow, okay, give me a second.
That whole verse. Is there a 12-step just for you?
Right, like, is there a course to understand? Our conversation's all in blue, I'm talking to myself. 11 haze, 10 fingers tearing out my hair, 9 times you never made it there. That there could be referring to 8 because she goes right to 7. I ate alone at 7, you were 6 minutes away. That was beautifully written.
Yeah.
What all you do is walk the other way to spend.
Okay.
You know what I really like about that song? It's so relatable for some and very realistic. Being in a relationship and you're giving 80% and they're only giving 20. Mm. And because you don't want it to seem like it's you, you create this excuse you create this excuse in your head that it's like, you know what? You're not into me because of me.
Right.
You're not into me because of personal reasons.
Right.
Hence, I just wish you were gay. I'm gonna tell myself that over and over, so it hurts less.
I like the fact that it separates itself from the other songs because it's strictly about insecurity in a way.
Yes.
But how the insecurity is created by being ignored constantly.
Yeah.
Finding a way to present this topic without being offensive, though, I think it's what impresses me the most.
She did it very well.
Because with most of these songs, like All the Good Girls Go to Hell, even Bad Guy, and Now Wish You Were Gay, and even Zanny, they're kind of controversial.
Yep.
If not topics, but titles. Like, you would see them and you'd be like, what's that one gonna be about?
Maybe like selfish?
Definitely selfish. Yeah. I think that she says it in the song. Like, it's definitely selfish.
Yeah.
Because it's just like, I can't find a reason why you don't feel the way that I feel about
so
you.
So I just may not be your sexual orientation.
That just has to be it.
It's also funny because this really happened to her.
Really?
Yeah, so I guess she was in a relationship and it didn't work out and the guy actually ended up coming out to her.
Are you reading that somewhere that I'm
I just read it. That is she funny. Finally looks like at the song and says,
damn, she a prophet? I know this one too.
Don't you know I'm no good for you? Tore my shirt to stop you bleeding. Why when I'm coming home and I'm on my own? I could lie, say I like it like that, like it like that. Don't you know too much already? Yeah, I could lie, say I like it like that, like it like that.
forgot how much I like that song.
Yeah, that's one of the songs that I definitely play the most by her. I love that
song.
It kind of hit differently this time. Probably's older.
I think it's got a lot to do with like being alone. I think that's why it's entitled "When the Party's Over." And it's almost like this toss-up of, do I like it like this? Or do I prefer company, maybe company of a loved one?
If I relate it back to "Wish You Were Gay," with feeling insecure and ignored, you can feel alone, even in the midst of that person's presence. So saying at the party, "I'll call you when it's over," right? That problem never gets dealt with. But sometimes when you come home and that person is quiet and has nothing to say because they're still upset, that's when you really feel alone. So I could lie and say I like it like that. I like coming home and being ignored. In a way, fooling herself.
Right, so it's not really sad.
No.
She's not sad.
I don't think that it's
sad. Could be a little more of irritation.
Yeah, and in a way that knowing within yourself that's like, it's time to pack up and go, but something in you won't. You know
I
what
see
I mean?
That a little bit more. Yeah.
So that's why I think that those two songs connect, because right. She already feels ignored and unappreciated.
Right.
So when it's too loud and y'all can't hear each other, both figuratively and literally.
Yeah.
Because when you're arguing, just trying to, you're not really hearing
you're
each other's side,
hearing
you're just
points.
Trying to defend yours.
Yeah.
I'll call you when the party's over. I'll call you when it's silent. I'll
yeah.
call you when the noise, you know, drowns out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
yeah.
I think that this was very interesting in context of the album.
The album, yeah.
Wait a minute, I love you, don't care.
But can you listen? Okay, coming off the back.
Yeah, this is gonna connect.
Of
these are
the last two songs, it sounds like there's an argument
these
or something going on.
Yeah, and this
and
be
she
after
sounds
that.
Childlike. You know when you're in an argument with somebody and they're flaring up? And you're just kind of like, okay, but can you listen? But can you listen? Can you please listen? It's like you feel like a child and cornered. I'm proud. The song ain't even start yet.
I can't commit.
Oh.
Guess I overdid.
Ooh.
Oh, I like that.
Think I better go.
Oh.
You're looking at me like I'm seeing through. How you feel? Do you even feel? You said don't treat me badly.
I love how the verses are with that.
But you said it so sadly.
I have such an
yeah. This definitely connects with when the party's over.
I have such a fucking like analysis right now. Can I say it? Do you want to keep going or what do you want me to do?
Let's keep going.
Oh my god.
I think I better go. I never really know how to please you. Do you even feel you? Anything.
Do you have any thoughts?
I do. When it comes to connecting with "You Were Gay" when the party's over, okay, we kind of made that connection.
Yeah.
Now connecting 8 and when the party's over, it's definitely a continuation. You sit in silence. There's obviously some type of animosity between her and this other person.
Right.
And I'll call you when the party's over. I'll get home. That's when we can talk. Get home. It's quiet. Ignore each other. No real type of conversation. So for me, 8 is the aftermath of that. And I think coming to the conclusion that she has hurt this person, and quite frankly, they may not be compatible.
How has she hurt this person?
I think with not knowing how to love them.
That's
what she said. It. I just never know how you feel. It's also a song to me about taking accountability. The fact that you're looking at me like I'm see-through means I haven't, or she has not done her job to allow that person to
shown
really
herself.
See
yeah.
her,
yeah.
and she has not shown herself.
That's fair.
So,
that's fair.
I don't take it as a blame song. I take it as a song of accountability and a little bit of reflection about her faults within this relationship.
I think that that's fair. I want to add to your point by saying, we started off this album by knowing she would take on many different personas. The fact that she is playing with different personas could also mean that she's speaking from the perspective of the person that's leaving her. I think if we kept 8 in this storyline, it definitely comes off as though she's having respect for herself and leaving. I'm not totally sure why the song's called 8, but I have an idea.
I read that it was a song originally called See Through.
Okay.
And I think she just named it 8 to play off the fact that it's the 8th song. It could be.
But okay. Also, even if it's the 8th song,
it could have to do with, is it Wish You Were Gay that had the number sequence within the verses? I don't know. What were you going to say? Is that Wish You Were
Gay? That's
Wish You Were Gay. I'm not sure.
We have to think about that. I feel like it's because it's playing off the idea of age and mentality. In the beginning of this song, it starts with a higher pitched voice kind of mimicking a child.
Yes.
And she has this like, wait, let me finish. I know you don't care, but can you listen? Kind of staying delusional and in this fantasy, like we can make this work though, we can make this work.
Yes.
And I noticed by the chorus, that childlike voice went away.
It's gone.
And it's her real voice kind of saying like, I'm coming out of that. And I'm snapping back into reality.
That's true.
So maybe that's why she called it 8.
That's true.
Of mentality and age.
If that is it, that's smart as shit.
No, Billy, I haven't done that dance since my wife died.
Don't ask questions. You don't wanna know. To be talking to you, but I don't know. Should have taken a break, not an extra comment.
To see that Michael's
car got it. Be my reliever, cause I don't self-medicate. And it burns like a gin and I like it, kinda like it. Bad, bad news, one of us is gonna lose.
Cool. Right?
Sounds right, yeah.
Did you like it? Did you like that?
Which part?
Oh, that's gonna go nice into Bury Your Friend.
And Bury Your Friend. I do like that song. Before we, you know, decided to do the revisit, I think we played it in the car. And I was like, oh damn, like, I didn't catch a song.
You played?
Oh. I heard it in the car.
With me?
Yeah, you were sleeping.
Oh.
You know, before getting into how it could potentially connect, I do think it's a really good song.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely like the Office inserts. I think that's really cool. It just adds a little bit of humor to it.
Yeah.
For, again, another kind of sinister beat and message. It's a little bit of a dark message. I think it's interesting, though, coming after 8 and her deciding to leave. I think maybe realizing that she has this odd
infatuation
with this person and can't stop thinking about them, hence them being the strange addiction and knowing that they don't blend well.
Right.
It's like almost oil and water.
Right.
But it's like, I can't stay away.
This was more so a concept song, if anything.
Yeah.
With the Office reading here being Billy's strange addiction, I think that that's a nice connection to reality.
Yeah.
Her reality. Mm-hmm. Don't think it's my favorite. I think the interludes make me appreciate it as something specifically for this album.
But not like the standalone song.
No.
Right, okay. Okay, makes sense.
The concept was really cool, though. And I do like how in the chorus that you are... We heard a little more vocal there.
A little stretching of the vocal, yeah.
Billy.
Come on now.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? Why do you care for me when we all fall asleep? Where do we go?
Come here.
Say it, spit it out. What is it exactly? The way I'm drinking you down, like I wanna drown, like I wanna hit you. Step on the grass, bury a friend, try to wake up. I wanna end me. I wanna end me. I wanna end me. Why don't you run for me?
Listen.
Keep you in the dark. What had you expected? Cause I'm so expensive. Your top would be something that shouldn't be said out loud.
I love that breakdown.
Honestly, I thought that I would be dead by now. Bury the hatchet or bury your friend right now. But then I owe God so much soul. Till my limbs are frozen, my eyes won't close. And bury a friend, try to wake up. I wanna end me.
Yeah, come on. So theatrical, like, I love this song. I love Bury a Friend. I think that is the best song on this album. You can obviously tell that that is where they got the inspiration from. I think that's where the album's theme clicked. I don't see where it could potentially flow with the album's potential sequencing, but I think it almost serves as like a title track.
I agree with you there.
Yeah.
Because I was reading on the side how Billy relates this to, like, the monster under your bed.
Right.
But I think that this song is really interesting, that concept of being your own worst enemy.
Mm-hmm.
It even feels like sometimes it plays with the idea of suicide.
Like, I want to end me, like that.
That whole idea that of I want to end me, but kind of even questioning, why do I want to end me? Like, you're almost surprised by your own thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
So becoming that monster and that worst enemy, this was an interesting way to play with that idea. Where the mind goes and the luring presence of a monster sometimes, and how they can kind of present themselves to be your friend.
Yeah. And then actually drag you down.
Yeah, which is like even with ourselves. You would think that you are yourself. Why would you be your own worst enemy?
But
that's when it's the most surprising.
Exactly. Yeah, I love the concept for that song.
Obviously, this song was a smash. Obviously, it was huge. Obviously, it's another recognizable hit.
Touching, that's a worry. But maybe that's a lie. Too close to start.
I feel like the relation between My Strange Addiction and Bury a Friend, the flip of Bury a Friend could be that this person she's addicted to is a monster as well. Sometimes being without that person can make you feel things you shouldn't. You kind of go crazy. That's almost like withdrawals.
Right, so I feel like this song is touching on separation because it's
separation,
it's
yeah.
It's coming straight after Bury a Friend. And so yeah, the friends I've had to bury, they keep me up at night.
Mm-hmm.
It's because you can't handle not
being around that
being
person.
With them. Yeah, exactly.
And here it even says that Elo Milo is a puzzle game where the player must unite Elo and Milo.
In order to come at the end.
In order to come at the end. Because I was going to say, the hurry, I'm worried, sounds like she's breaking up. And they're getting further and further away from each other.
Come,
ooh, I love details.
Yeah,
like you got the two, right?
Yeah, every time I said, hurry, I'm worried. I can't lose another life.
It sounded video game like something was breaking up.
Yes.
So cool.
That I couldn't love someone because I
an ode to Zanny?
Yeah, kind of connecting
all these songs.
These songs and putting them together. Because this is a song like about loss, it's a song about finding, it's a song about missing, it's a song about damn.
Shit.
Tell me you come home. Even
if it's just a lie. When the party's over.
Adrenaline.
Did you go? I should know. Care if it's a lie.
That ending was very nightmare-like as well.
Yes, yes. I always thought that Bury a Friend and Elo Milo were the best songs on the album. I think just
really?
Because, to me personally, yes, because I just think they complement each other so well.
So you have heard quite a bit of this album.
I have, but even listen before I go, I love you. I heard it when it first came out, but that was back in 2019. So it's been a while.
But you've heard majority of this album.
I've heard majority of this album, unknowingly. I think that song It fits the aesthetic. Again, it's very chilling, it's very haunting, but it has this sense of variation. And again, I just think that fear of separation really, really ties in well.
Take me to the rooftop, the world when I stop breathing. Tell me love is endless. Like you do. Sorry, can't save me now. Sorry, there's no way in. Sorry, but down. Taste me, the salty tears on my.
Definitely.
Oh shit.
Definitely. Definitely. Did you hear that gasp of air at the end?
Because I was looking at the lyrics and I said, call my friends and tell them that I love them and I miss them, but I'm not sorry. Call my friends and tell them I love them and I miss them. Sorry.
Sorry. Sorry is the, yeah.
Sorry was the key.
Definitely
I said.
Definitely about suicide.
Okay. Wow.
And listen before I go, which listen I think is a double, because it's like, okay, listen to this before I go, but also listen to me. Before I go. I knew from the beginning, take me to the rooftop, I want to see the world when I stop breathing.
Mm. Dang, that didn't hit the first time I heard that.
And even, okay, and with sorry there's no way out, but down, could that relate to all good girls go to hell?
Yeah, but then I also think just downhill.
No, definitely.
But yeah, that definitely does really, I think maybe that definitely can correlate with all the good girls go to hell. Yes.
Sometimes you don't think you can ever get to this place again.
Yeah.
Wow, that song was layered.
That song.
And it's toward the end, so listen before, you know, I end this album.
True.
It's not true. Tell me I've been lied to. Ooh. Never been the type. Ooh. Maybe won't you take it back? Say you were trying to make me laugh. You didn't mean to say I love you. And I don't want to. Up all night.
Mm.
Oh, wow.
It's the details.
Yeah.
I wish we never learned to fly. Didn't mean to make you cry. For nothing has to change today. It didn't mean to say I love you.
So funny how you hear I listen before I go, and you know that was pretty like, geez. And then you hear this song and it's as slow and peaceful as it is, it's very sweet. It's realizing that as much as I don't want to love you, as much as I really do want to block off any kind of emotion, mm-hmm. I really do love you. I take it as reversed. That is what she wants that person to listen to before she goes.
Mm.
That's what I take that as.
Coming right before.
Almost like a note. And then it's goodbye.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's the thing I said. That's the thing she wants that person to listen to.
I agree.
Just so they know.
Yeah.
Beautiful song.
I also get from this song the possibility that it could be from the other person's perspective after she goes.
Oh.
Because.
Okay. That too.
That smile that you gave me, even when you felt like dying, could speak to like, listen before I go is where she goes. And then this person kind of comes and says, afterwards. Yeah, because that can happen a lot where you can lose a person and realize, wait, I really did feel that way about you.
Wow. Hmm.
I didn't expect a song like that on this album though. That slow and that sweet. I really didn't. That one came as a surprise and a shock to me. Yeah. This was about harmonies. This was about
definitely
the
vocal.
Voice.
Yeah, definitely.
Absolutely.
Please don't leave me. Oh shit, is she about to blend every song?
It's not true.
It's in reverse. That was iconic.
To take every song and have that be the outro, if that's in reverse, that's cool as shit.
And ending it with, I'm the bad guy, still speaks to the idea that she's played so many different people here.
But at the end of the day, I'm still the bad guy.
Elo Milo told you not to worry, take me to the rooftop. As soon as I heard that, I knew it was Listen Before I Go. And I was like, it's not true, I love you.
No, that's from I Love You.
But why did she choose that line? And then ends the album by saying, I'm the bad guy.
Because if you were to flip that in perspective, she's saying everything I just stated is not true.
Exactly.
Oh, that's...
Was that what she mean?
That is good. The only other person you showed me that did that was John Bellion, where they took every song...
And Hand of God.
On the last track. And referenced every single one of them. That was good.
That was good.
Because
there was good. Because I could have easily ended at I Love You, but for an album like this I needed something a little more wild.
Exactly.
And that was wild.
She gave it.
Wow.
Billie Eilish, this album is incredible. A debut album like this... I remember when it dropped, this thing broke records.
Yeah.
And you see why. She stuck to the sound that best fits her, but also allowed you to see the difference in her voice.
Yeah.
And what she can do with her voice. Phineas, you are a good fucking producer, and you know how to make a very cohesive body of work and what sounds good for your sister.
Yeah. There's nothing like this, in my opinion, especially today. Like, even if this is inspired by things that came before, I see that she's pulled inspiration from films, from TV shows, from life in itself.
Oh, music, like...
A project like this, though, I think the reason why it hits so hard is because it's really not that mainstream.
It's not!
But it's delivery. Because it's so odd. It's so abstract.
But then you take these haunting songs
and
you give them these playful inserts. It just works and it sticks to Billie's personality. I can't wait to see what she's about to do with her sophomore album. I can't wait. I don't know what direction she's going to take it, but this was incredible.
This was such an interesting and intriguing listen the whole way through. It was
God.
It wasn't predictable at all.
As always, we'd love to know what you guys thought about the album. Let us know your top 3 down below in the comments.
If you enjoyed watching this react, remember to like, comment, and subscribe. Turn on those post notifications, that way you know when we upload. And we'll catch you guys on the next one.